so caught up in the teaching last week about the name I Am for Jesus that before I leave on vacation for a couple weeks and then return, I wanted to just spend one more week on the seven I Ams of Jesus. In fact, then I got involved in my study, realized, no, this will be a two-weeker. So we're going to go through the first four of what are the seven I Ams of Jesus in the Gospel of John. And then on Communion Sunday when I return, we'll go through the last three and link them into communion. And then right after that, yes, we'll return to 1 John and begin chapter 5 together. But this is a topical message, not going verse by verse this Sunday, but we're going to go kind of verse through verse. We're going to take a look at four of the seven statements where Jesus links his great title, I Am, to a quality of who he is, and it will stir and comfort your heart, I know. To launch all that, we're going to go to the foundational text that we talked about last week, John 8:58, where Jesus gave himself this title, I Am the Eternal Self-Existent God. In verse 58, hear the word of God with me. Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. This is the word of God. May we hear from him in all of his greatness. Amen. You can be seated. Names. In our society, they're often meaningful, but sometimes they fade in their meaning and get used to them. But I can guarantee you there are one or two linkages in my life where I'll never have the meaning of names lost. I was we were playing with two of our grandkids this past week and got the little pool out in the backyard and then they got the sand table and they got all these things. We have a little rock garden at our new place, and so, you know, my grandson likes to just go out on his own and build things with rocks. Who says boys and girls aren't different? I'm telling you right now. Just get two grandkids together and watch. That's all I can say. It's a scientific experiment with an inevitable result. Anyway, she'll talk, he'll build. What are you going to do? But anyway. Okay. So he was building some stuff out of some rocks, and it was getting a little out of hand. And his dad, Tom, had come by to pick him up, I think. I forget. But I was kind of in the porch area, and he walked out into the backyard around to where my grandson was playing, and I didn't even see where they were, but I heard, Liam Joseph! Now, Liam heard that and went, whoa! I heard that, and my heart melted, because he was they gave his middle name after me. And names can mean things, and that meant a lot to me. Almost as much as the fact that my son, Joseph, is named after me and my father. Names mean something. It means, you know, when you get to a certain point in life that you know that that person, God willing, will be an echo of you after you're no longer physically present. Liam Joseph will be, hopefully, God willing, if the Lord doesn't tarry, I mean, if the Lord does tarry and my grandson grows into faith, my prayer is that Liam Joseph will be very clearly inscribed on his baptismal certificate. If the Lord should tarry still further, my prayer is that he'll meet a wonderful Christian girl and they'll discover the joys of marriage together, and that someone someday, probably not me, but someone someday will stand over them and will join them in marriage, and his name, Liam Joseph, will be proclaimed again and onward in his life. Names are meaningful. In our society, they're an echo of who we are and who we wish to be remembered as. But in the Bible, we have names immortalized, don't we? We have names that are not only explained to us in their meaning, but then those that bear the names live out the meanings for better or for worse. And it's just interesting when you take a look at the names in the Scripture, some of them carry some great stories, and you can see why God personally sometimes named people. Names are especially meaningful when you move into the Bible world. God named the first man Adam. Maybe you don't know what this The meaning of that is he made him Adam because Adam was made from the dust of the ground, Genesis 1:26. And in Hebrew, Adam or Adam means earth. But you didn't know that. There's a meaning to it all. Adam was the beginning of it all, created by the very act of God. Highlights the sacredness of human life. God changed Abram's name to Abraham, which means the father of many nations. And that was a perfect description of God's will for Abraham's life, that he would give birth to the nation of Israel, and the nation of Israel would give birth to the Messiah, and the Messiah would give birth to spiritual birth in the lives of people all over in many nations, including Bangladesh this morning, and the United States this morning, and many nations would rejoice because of the great descendant of Abraham, the father of many nations. So God named him because of the plan that he had for him. And when Abraham and Sarah were getting up in years, and they still hadn't had the son that God had promised that all of this would come through, when God did promise, oh, don't you worry, this time next year, Sarah will have a son. And he was 100 and she was in her 90s, and Sarah laughed. Well, that time next year they did have a son, and what was that son named? Isaac, which means laughter. You better watch out. God remembers idle conversations. I just find it fascinating how God has hung all this in the Bible. Then some of them you would probably know. Jesus changed Simon's name. Simon meant listener. In other words, somebody was always kind of looking for the right thing to do, kind of timid. Simon was named, his name was changed to Peter, which means rock. Now, at the time his name was changed, one author said he may have looked more like a shifting sand than a strong rock, but Jesus saw the potential and he knew what he was going to do through Simon and how he was going to make him the rock of the early church through his preaching of the gospel. And so Simon lived into his new name, didn't he? So names mean things. Well, if you think the names of everyday believers meant something in the Bible, when we come to the names of Jesus, they are the most important names in the Bible because Jesus is God. And so I've been going through on Communion Sundays a mini-series called His Names Are Wonderful, and we've taken a look at some of the major names of Jesus, like Jesus or Yeshua, like Lord, like Redeemer, and other names. Last week, we took a look at what I call the most majestic and the most meaningful name, the name I Am, which is a name that's a statement, right? It's the most unusual name that we have of Jesus. And we saw in John 8:58, which I just read to you, where Jesus gave himself that name. It's a name in which he said, before Abraham was 2,000 years ago, I am. It's a fascinating statement that he is God. He is the timeless, eternal God, and that there is no past, present, or future with him. He simply is. He's outside of time. And when Abraham was living 2,000 years ago, Jesus was there. In fact, Jesus said, I'm still in the past. Even though the past has evolved from your point of view, I'm God, I stand outside of it. I'm now in the future, Jesus was saying, even though I'm also right here, present with the beating of your heart and your life. So it was a great statement of deity, of divinity. And it was borrowed from Exodus 3, which was read in our hearing today, when God himself identified himself to Moses. And he said, when Israel asks, or should they ask, what my name is, you tell them, I am that I am. And so it was a name that Jesus took upon himself that the Jewish people already knew from ancient Old Testament history, and there was no mistaking what Jesus was saying to those people. I am God. I am the Son of God, and I am just as much God as God the Father, whom you followed all of your lives, was and is. And they got the message because in verse 59, it says they picked up stones to throw at him because he was claiming to be God, and that was blasphemy to the Jews. So we see here it's a name that basically says Jesus is the eternal, self-existent God. He has always been. He doesn't need anything out of himself to exist. No one ever created him. No one ever conceived of the idea of him. He has always been, and that's a characteristic of God. God cannot have a beginning, otherwise there's someone or something greater than him, right? So Jesus is God. He identified himself with that. And the words I am in the Old Testament are the words that we can, our best guess is that they sounded like Yahweh in the Hebrew. The Tetragrammaton, the four-lettered great statement of I am. You could also link Jehovah with that title. And when you look in your Old Testament in the English, when it's capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, that's a translation of this great name of God, Lord Yahweh, God the Eternal One, the eternal self-existent of God. Now, this name is so powerful that Jesus intentionally linked it seven times in the Gospel of John to certain other qualities about him that show that he's God. Seven different times, and Bible teachers, ever since John's Gospel was written in the 90s, in the 90s AD, Bible teachers have read through the Gospel of John, and they've seen these seven I Ams stand out, and they've been preached thousands of times, the seven I Ams of Jesus. And I'm going to run through them in two messages, just hitting the highlights. I understand one of our Bible studies is going to go into them in depth in our women's ministry in the fall, and I think that's a wonderful study. You can never get to the bottom of these. So Jesus attached I am to seven other qualities to expand their understanding that he is God. They're all in the Gospel of John, the first four today. Each one, I'm going to talk about the meaning it bears. In other words, what did he mean when he added the title to himself? And then I'm going to talk about the impact that it shares. In other words, why does it matter? Why did it matter to his hearers? And why does it matter to you as a believer in your life today, in your battles today? And interestingly enough, we're going to go through them sequentially. So if you have your Gospel of John, go back to John chapter 6. And we're going to start, and we're just basically over these two Sundays going to go one after the other from chapter 6 through the Gospel of John. And I'm just going to take one or two verses from each to show you his teaching. So this is a topical message that follows a theme. Now, the very first time Jesus used I am and connected it to an aspect of who he was as God is way back in John chapter 6, not way back, but a few chapters back from where you are, in John chapter 6 and verse 35. We'll take a look at it, and then we're going to go back and take a look at the whole situation to give you some insight. Jesus said to them, who's the them? It was a crowd of people following him on the seashore there in Galilee. He said, I am, there it is, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Now, there's more places in which this is expanded in this chapter, but that's the foundational text. I am the bread of life. Now, that one, like some of the others, is a bit... What word could I use? Symbolic, but filled with powerful meaning. The bread of life. What could he be talking about? What is he comparing himself to? What is he trying to illustrate and communicate at the same time? Well, in order to understand it, you need to understand the whole situation in which Jesus made this statement. This occurs a little over halfway through his ministry, and it occurs in the upper regions of Israel known as Galilee, and it occurs on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. But in order to understand what is happening in John 6:35, you actually have to go back to understand what had happened just the day before. What had happened just the day before? Well, if you go back to the beginning of chapter 6, we aren't going to read the verses, but chapter 6, verse 1, all the way through chapter 12, is the feeding of the 5,000. One of the great miracles of Jesus. Thousands of people on a hillside had listened to his teaching all day, and they were without food. And Jesus performs the miracle of the fish and the loaves. A lot of you remember the story. Little boy in the crowd with a few fish and a couple of barley loaves to feed thousands of people. It was probably more like 15,000 because according to Hebrew tradition, they only counted the men that were present. And there were probably at least twice as many women and children present. So the feeding of the 5,000 was more like the feeding of the 15,000, all covering this hillside. And Jesus, with a couple of fish and a couple of loaves of barley, just keeps handing out fish and barley all across that hillside. The disciples lining up with their baskets, coming back to get more and taking it out to everybody in the crowd. This moving miracle happens. And everybody eats till they're so full, they don't want to eat anymore. And so Jesus sends the disciples out through the crowd with their empty baskets, and he has them bring back the leftovers. And according to verse 12, they gathered up the leftovers, and according to verse 13, they filled 12 baskets with it. I always loved that. One basket for each doubting disciple. Whoa. He let them hold a miracle for the afternoon. So all this happens. The disciples are amazed. The people are energized. Now, if you take a look at verse 14, you won't see it on the screen, but I'll just read this to you. You might, but it says, they gathered up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. When the people saw the sign, the miracle that he had done, they said, this is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world. Perceiving that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. What's that all about? Well, you have to know your Old Testament. Back in Deuteronomy chapter 18, Moses was talking about the distant future of the people of Israel. And he said, as stiff-necked as you guys are, you're God's chosen people. And one day he's going to send you a Messiah. He's going to send you a Messiah, and he will be a prophet like me. He will be the greatest prophet in the history of Israel, the history of the world. Now, what do you associate with the life and the work of Moses? Well, Jews, I'll tell you what Jews associated with Moses. Moses and manna. What was manna? Manna was bread, basically. It was very thin, wafer-like, crystalline bread that God brought down out of heaven miraculously every day as the children of Israel made their way through the wilderness in order to miraculously feed them. You remember the story of manna. Every morning, they came out of their tents and the manna covered the ground. And they would go out and gather the manna and they would eat it and be satisfied. It was miracle food. It was bread that they found on the grass every single day, and it was a sign of God's presence and God's power. What do you think they had just seen, and what do you think they connected it with? Here's Jesus creating manna before their very eyes. Miraculously, it covered the ground. It filled the baskets full. And what did they conclude? After they'd seen blind people being healed, lame people being healed, every kind of disease being healed, demons cast out, even dead people they'd heard had been raised, they concluded, he's Messiah. He is the prophet. Behold, this is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world. Were they right or wrong? Yes. They were right. He was the prophet. He was the Messiah. But they believed he had come to take over Israel, become an immediate king, defeat all the enemies of Israel, and make Israel at the top point of the world's politics, and bring them into a golden age where there was bread and fish all the time. They had no idea what the prophets had said, that before he comes as their conquering king, he's going to have to first come as a suffering servant. Remember that? He's going to go to the cross to die and purchase their eternal life before he comes back and blesses their physical life. Well, they didn't understand that part, or if they had, they'd forgotten it. They wanted to make him a physical king and have bread like this every day. And so they started, verse 15, to take him by force, to make him king, take him to Jerusalem, parade him in his Messiah. Well, Jesus withdrew from them, because he knew that his real role was to go to a cross for them and die for them and purchase spiritual freedom for them, not political freedom. Make sense? Well, Jesus goes up to a mountain to pray. He sends the disciples out on their boat, does another miracle where he walks on the water to rescue them. That's the next part of the chapter. He gets to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. The people wake up the next morning. Jesus, the miracle worker, isn't here. Well, they beat feet and they get all the way over to the other side of the lake to find Jesus again. Why? They want some more miracle bread. They chase Jesus down and they say, Rabbi, what in the world are you doing? How'd you get over here? We expected you over there. And Jesus says in verse 26, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. You're totally fixated on the physical. You're totally fixated on the here and now and on having your hunger satisfied. Do not labor for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life. You got to focus on what I'm here to do spiritually, to be your Savior. You got a bigger problem than an empty stomach. You've got empty souls. You're heading to hell. Oh, labor for the food that endures to eternal life. Look at this, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal. Yes, I am the prophet, but before I become the prophet for the nations, I got to go be the Savior for the world. That's what will please the Father right now. So you have this tremendous encounter, and Jesus says, you're focusing on all the wrong things. Now, with all of that as an understanding, read verse 35 again. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. He's talking there about spiritual satisfaction. He's talking there about salvation. He's trying to tell them, get your eyes off the physical and understand your spiritual need to be saved. And I am the bread of that life. You have to take me in order to experience that kind of forever nourishment. Their focus was physical and temporal. The true focus should have been spiritual and eternal. Now, I've taken a lot of time on this first particular quality of the four because it needed the most emphasis so you understand the background of it. Well, let me get to the two questions that help you understand this. The bread of life. The first question is, what did he mean then? I put it in a sentence for you. Jesus was telling them, as God, I alone can satisfy spiritual hunger. That's what it is in verse 35. I am as God. That's a statement that I am God. And as God, I am the bread of life. And if you come to me and understand that I died for your sin and that and you take me into your life as Savior and Lord, you receive me, I will bring spiritual nourishment to you that you'll never need again. You'll not hunger and you'll never thirst. I'll give you eternal satisfaction. As God, I alone can satisfy spiritual hunger. You see, he was talking about salvation. He was talking about full spiritual satisfaction. I tell you what, I met Jesus Christ as a young college student, and I've been through a lot of ups and downs in my personal life and my spiritual life over the years, but I've never found a Savior like him. I've never gone to another. I've never wanted to go to another. Even when I doubted his will in my life and I was suffering under his will for my life, and even though I was darkened in my attitude toward him at times and struggling and carnal, which all Christians struggle with. Don't look at me with those stunned faces. Yeah, your pastor's had spiritual dark times too. But in all my spiritual dark times, I have never looked for and never found a Savior like Jesus Christ. I've never doubted his love for me, and I've never doubted that I am his and that he solved my spiritual hunger. Once you come to know him like that, no other religion, no other Savior can speak to your life like this. What did he mean? As God, I alone can satisfy spiritual hunger. Second question, why does it matter? This is the part where it bears a message for you. I put it into a phrase. It matters because Jesus is the only way to know God and grow in God. Now, I put that in two separate sentences because as he goes on here, he shows you that receiving the bread of life happens in two ways for a person. The first way is in salvation. That's in verse 53. Go farther. He said, I'm the bread of life now. And so he gets to the practical. What do they do with him as the bread of life? Jesus said to them, verse 53, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. Now, what's he talking about? There's been different interpretations and some confusion on this issue, but I don't think it's that confusing. The word in verse 53 that says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man, is the word phagein, meant to eat something, and it's in the aorist tense in the Greek, which in other words, it means you do it once and once only. It's an action in the past in a point in time. Some have, in my opinion, with all respect, mistakenly looked at this and said that that's talking about communion, and that's talking about taking the wafer and the wine, and when you do that, that transfers some spiritual power to you. I disagree with that for a couple of reasons. Number one, it completely violates the spirit of the teaching of the whole chapter. Jesus was trying to get them away from looking at this as talking about physical bread and physical wine. So it completely violates the theme and the emphasis of the whole passage. Secondly, communion was not something that he had introduced to them. Communion is something that he introduces for the church. And he does that months later in the upper room with those that were going to be part of the church. Communion was something for the church. It was their celebration. It was not for the Jewish people that were listening to him. You see, he's talking about spiritual life. And what does it mean in 53, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man? Now, you may disagree, but here's what I believe. And by the way, Protestant teachers and biblical teachers over the centuries have agreed with me. This means trusting Christ and receiving him as your Savior at a point in time that doesn't have to be repeated. That's a third reason why I don't think this relates to communion. Communion is taught by some. It has to be repeated, and if you don't take it, you've fallen out of grace with God and you've lost your salvation. That's not possible because the text talks about a one-time act. When is that one time for you? It's when you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior. And like I like to say, whether it happens when you're 6 or 60, it happens once. I haven't retrusted Christ as my Savior every day. I did it that one time in a midnight of my life, and I've never done it again. So the first time you eat, you take on the bread of life is when you get saved. The second is as you grow, and that's down in verse 56. He says, whoever feeds on my flesh, notice that, that's kind of a different expression, and drinks my blood, abides in me, and I in him. What is that talking about? That's a different Greek word, trogon, and I'm not being facetious or light here. Sometimes you get confused by my sense of humor. I know I'm hard to understand, and I'm weird, but trogon is an interesting little Greek word. You don't find it much. And it meant to munch. It meant to snack. And he's basically, I think he's saying here, after you have taken me in as your Savior in that one-time event, learn to munch on the truth about me. Learn to take in, and this is a scriptural idea, in the Old Testament in Jeremiah and other places, the Word of God was often described as bread. The Word of God was often described as something you munched on, you ate, you let it come down into your soul. I think Jesus is saying here, once you get saved, take my truth in on a regular basis, munch on it, snack on it, eat it all day long, and when my truth comes into that new man that I've made in you, when you found me as Savior, you're going to grow, and the more you grow, the closer you'll be to me. And look at this, you'll abide in me, and I in you. You'll be closer to me, and you'll know I'm closer to you. Does that make any sense? Thank you for the three of you that nodded. This is spiritually symbolic stuff, folks. A lot of pastors won't touch this because it's not practical or simple. Well, the Bible is sometimes neither one, but it's always truthful. Jesus was stretching their categories. He said, don't look at just the physical. Understand the spiritual nature of your life. You need to get saved, and then you need to stay near. I hope this helps you. By the way, Trogon there, Munch, or if whoever feeds on my flesh, verse 56, is in the present active participle construction in the Greek, which means you're doing it all the time. So there's a difference between these two. The first one is salvation. The second is sanctification. And they're both done by faith. They're not accomplished by any ceremony. No ceremonies in this chapter. You have more questions about that, I'll be happy to talk with you afterward, because I know some of you guys come from different traditions. But you see, it's all about the question, have you truly trusted Christ as Savior and Lord? Have you received Jesus according to John 1? How do you do that? Not through a wafer, but through a decision of faith, seeing your sin and seeking your Savior, repenting of your sin and asking Him to come into your life as your Savior and your Lord. And that happens at a point in time, and then it changes your whole time. Has that happened to you? Some people tell me, I say, when did you become a Christian? And they say, well, I've always gone to church. But that's not what I asked you. You see, some people really believe that they became a Christian when somebody took them to church. And since they were small at the time, that somebody kept taking them to church. And they got into a habit, and when they got older, they took themselves to church. But here's the problem. It's not when somebody takes you to church, it's one day when you take in the sun yourself. I don't care where you are, I care where He is. Does that make sense to you? It's interesting that the first I am of the seven in John is so salvationally focused. Okay, we're going to go to at least two or three more today. Second is maybe one of the most familiar, John chapter 8 now. And we're going to go to John chapter 8, verse 12, where Jesus said, I am, as God, the light of the world. Read the text. John 8, 12. Jesus again spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Now, if the first situation in John 6 was made clear because we took a look at the situation, what happened the day before and what they were really thinking, you need to look at this one, and I think thinking about the location will help you understand what he was saying. You say, location? What are you talking about? Well, verse 2 of chapter 8 says that this teaching took place in the temple in the morning, early in the morning. And if you go back all the way to verse 20, this whole teaching of Jesus from verse 12 all the way through verse 20 through verse 19 is one lengthy teaching. And look where it says it all happened. Verse 20, these words he spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, but no one arrested him because his hour had not yet come. Let me go back to the first part of that verse. These words he spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple. Temple was a massive place, football fields, multiple football fields in length and in width. It could house tens of thousands of people on the great feast days. It was divided into different sections. I believe the treasury was also near a place called the Court of the Women, and it was a huge area where many thousands could congregate. And the Bible scholars that I've looked at believe that this teaching took place right after one of the great feasts of Israel. There were three great feasts of Israel, and the one that this took place right after was called the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Sukkot for my Messianic friends in the Jewish community today. The Feast of Tabernacles was designed to celebrate the release of Israel from Egypt and how God guided them through the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire through all their years through the wilderness when they lived in tents, tabernacles. It was designed to celebrate him. It is also called a feast of light. Now, what I want to point out to you is in the temple area, in the treasury area, near the court of the women, there were four golden candelabra. You know what a candelabra is? How many know what a candelabra is? It's basically a big Jewish lamp, oil lamp. It has seven seven kind of sprouts that come up, and they have oil lamps on the top. And they were designed according to God's instructions in the Old Testament to be placed in the area of worship. The Jews ended up placing four of these in that area. Now, they weren't just something you put on a table. Get this. One expert I looked at this week said they were each 75 feet tall. Whoa. Now, that area, the Court of the Women, was an open area. The two outer areas of the temple were open to the air. And then you got to the temple building itself and you went into the holy place, which had was enclosed in stone. And then the Holy of Holies enclosed in stone. But the biggest part of the temple was all open in the air, and it was in the middle of Jerusalem. Well, these giant candelabra had these wells of oil at the bottom, and the oil was fed up to these lamps on the top. And in the Feast of Tabernacles, because it was a feast of light to celebrate the fact that when God led Israel, he led them as a pillar of fire. Who was in the pillar of fire? God. And so all seven nights of the Feast of Tabernacles, the priests would light these four gigantic candelabra in the courtyard there. People who were eyewitnesses at the time wrote in Jewish history that these four candelabra, when they were going, were so bright that they lit up the entire city of Jerusalem. And they were lit up every night for seven nights. To remind them of the pillar of fire, which was God was in the fire. To remind them of also the promise that there would be a light who would come to the peoples again. Who would that be? Jesus, the Messiah. Well, they thought the Messiah was going to come, and that's true. A light to the world, a light to the place in Israel. And thirdly, that light would be Messiah. But what they missed was that light was Jesus. Remember, they were looking for this Messiah who would take armies over and just put everything into a political light. No. What if Jesus, it says he was in that area right after the Feast of Tabernacles was over, verse 20. This is just me creatively thinking, so this isn't gospel. Jesus is standing there. What if he turned around to the great candelabra? They weren't lit now. They were still blackened at their tops from having been lit for seven nights. What if he turned around and looked at those now unlit candelabra and said, "I am the light of the world. I am the light that God said would come into the world. I am the Messiah you're waiting for." I don't know about you. I think God's a fan of timing and situations. I'd bet a dinner that's what happened. That's just me. So take a look at it again. John 8:12. He said to them, "I am the light of the world." Not just the light of Israel. Notice the terminology. They were looking for somebody that was a light for their country, their society, because they were the people of God. We're the ones that when God comes back, he's coming back for us. All the lost dogs of the Gentile world, Who did Jesus say he's the light for? "I am the light of the world. I'm the light for Israel. I'm the light for the Samaritans. I'm the light for the Chaldeans. I'm the light for the Greeks. I'm the light for the Romans. I'm the light for the Bangladeshians who are to come. I'm the light for the Americans who are to come. I'm the light for the Colombians. I'm the light for the Russians. I'm the light for all who are to come, because they will all be born in spiritual darkness. I will be their light." He looked ahead in history to you and says, "I'm going to be a light for him, for her. I'm the light of the world, and whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." I hope you get my point. This was a moment. It was a moment when Jesus declared he was the Savior of the world. my two questions. What did he mean then? I put it in a sentence for you. As God, he was saying, I alone can give you moral light. What do you need to get saved? You need moral clarity. You need to suddenly see your sin for what it is. A minute ago, you were just completely lackadaisical about it. You didn't care. But when the Spirit of God comes and Jesus, the light of the world, breaks on your mind, you suddenly see your sin for what it is. You need moral clarity to be saved. He's the one that gives you that. Notice he doesn't say, I am one of the many lights of the world. That's what a lot of people believe today. I mean, Jesus, lots of people from different religious backgrounds will say, well, Jesus was a noble man. He was one of the prophets. He was one of the most spiritually insightful people to live. No, he wasn't. He was the light of the world. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He was the most intolerant religious leader of all time. So, if he alone can give you moral light, when does that come? It starts at salvation. Look at this. Whoever follows me, you make a decision. I've been following me all my life. When the Spirit of God comes and Jesus convicts you of your sin, you need to make a decision to stop following your way and repent and start following his way. That's salvation, my friend. And you know what's happening when you see a change in somebody's life. I've noticed over the years that the light of the gospel irritates sinners, but it attracts seekers. That's why I don't try hard to pound on somebody to make some kind of verbal decision for Jesus. Hey, it's not my job. If God is breaking on their heart, God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, light irritates sinners. John, just read John 3. But it attracts seekers. And that continues in sanctification. I think sanctification is in the next phrase. Whoever follows me, that's salvation, will not walk in darkness. That's the future of their spiritual life. It suddenly changes. They come from darkness to light, Jesus says, but will have the light of life. That's your future as a Christian. You come to Christ, you come out of darkness, you never go back again. Does God ever call Christians children of darkness again? No, you're children of light. And now you grow in your walk. That's sanctification. So the first phrase follows is salvation, not walking in darkness, but having the light of life is sanctification. Why it matters is the second question. But if Jesus Christ says he is the light of the world, and if you follow him and you walk with him, you will not walk in darkness. Here's my conclusion, and I put in a sentence that may disturb some of you. Moral confusion should not be normal for the Christian. What do I mean by that? I mean when you get saved, you get a new mind, you get God's perspective on moral truth. And his word suddenly opens up to you. You begin to understand it. And it's very clear on most issues that will affect you. So why do I meet more Christians today who are saying, well, when it comes to certain things of sexuality, you know, the Bible's probably not trustworthy on those verses. Why? Well, because it just doesn't make sense to what we know about sexuality these days. Or when it comes to certain moral choices about ethics. Well, we're evolving. Our whole society is evolving, and I need to evolve. Evolving, I didn't mean revolving. Evolving. I think it's devolving, but that's another story. Anyway. And I want to be in touch with the evolving thinking about certain ethical and moral issues. And I think the Bible is just, it was written by people that were trapped in an ancient culture. And it only reflects the very limited culture that they lived in at the time. You have to look at the Bible in light of all the cultural context. And in light of our cultural context today, it does not apply. It's interesting, in my Bible, Jesus did not say, I am the light of the world until the world gets a better light. I am the light of the world until the world evolves to something more powerful, more ingenious, more enlightened, more nuanced, if you want to use the overworked word of our society today. Even to issues of crime and punishment. We're taking a look at what the ancient texts of the Bible say that formed the healthiest moral framework of any society in history, and we're saying we're dumping the old biblical frames because they just don't work with the informed modern mind. Well, you know what? You can have all those arguments you want. But if Jesus said, I am the light of the world, and if you follow me, you will not walk in darkness. I'll just tell you this. If what he's saying is true, the moral confusion should not be normal for the Christian. My Bible says so many times over, thus saith the Lord. That's the essence of how he reveals himself. He is the truth teller. Without question. We're going to do one more and then we'll close. You run that around today. You think it's not relevant to American society. Go to chapter 10 real quickly. Jesus said, I am the door. Chapter 10 and verse 9. Again, he's using this imagery that may be confusing. He says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. Wow. Again, if you understand the context, it helps. The context is shepherding life, right? Because go farther down, he explains, I am the good shepherd, verse 11. We'll deal with that next time. He's talking about shepherding life. Now, what do you need to know about shepherding life? Well, shepherding life was a dawn-to-dusk business, as you can imagine. The shepherd would lead the sheep out of the fold in the early morning, and he would take them to the place that had the best grass. Sheep are interesting. They eat fast, and they eat stupidly. They can clear out a field fast. They just put their heads down and they just destroy it. And so the shepherd always had to stay with them to lead them to new grass, because a sheep will eat through the green grass and it'll eat right down into the dirt and it'll eat down into the roots and he'll eat anything that's there and starve himself. So the shepherd had to constantly watch where they were and lead them to green pastures. Take that one home with you. And he would do that all day long, and then when dusk began to approach, he would take them back at sunset to the fold. What's a fold? It was a rock enclosure that the shepherds had built with large rocks, and they would build it up to a height of maybe this high, just a few feet, because sheep can't jump very well. And it was somewhat circular, and they would lead the sheep in by name to count them at the end of the day to make sure none were lost. They would lead the sheep in by name, and then, very interestingly enough, the shepherd, the door to the fold, that didn't have a wooden door, didn't have any kind of door, it was open. Some of you know where I'm going on this. So the shepherd's last act as the sun set and all the sheep were counted and were in the fold is he would lay himself down at the opening of the sheepfold. And he would lie there all night long. No sheep could get through him. No enemy could get through him. John 10:9. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. He's the only way in. He lays down his life to be there. Amazing, huh? Fast, two quick questions. What did he mean? I put it in a phrase for you. Jesus was saying, as God, as the I am, I alone am the door to eternal safety. He didn't say, I'm one of many doors for the sheep. He didn't say, if you really want a door, I guess I'll be one. But you don't need it. You can jump right over. He said, I am the door. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. I am is very, very clear. You know what I am means? It means no other. I love that name. And why does it matter? I put in a phrase for you. Eternity, ministry, and security are the privileges of his flock. You see, I believe they're all wrapped up in this phrase. Look at it, verse 9, and we close. I am the door. I am the way of salvation. I'm the only way for you to come in to have everlasting safety and security. The fold represents heaven for the sheep of God. So it represents eternity. But then he says this, if anyone enters by me, he will be saved. So we're talking salvation here. Saved from the spiritual enemy, the wolf out there. You can see that develop later in verse 12. But he will also be able to go in and out. What's that? A lot of people have different opinions. My opinion is, once you're in the flock, he gives you a ministry. I think going in and out means going out and in and out and serving God throughout your life till you get to heaven. Just, you know, you can take it your way. That's my way. That's ministry. So once you're saved, you have a ministry. You can go in and out and he'll be with you in your ministry, in your serving, in your obedient Christian life, in your sanctification, in your walk with God. No matter where you are, the great shepherd knows where it is. And finally, you can go in and out and find pasture. That links back to the bread of life part, doesn't it? I'll always be there to feed you. I'll always be there to give you good ground. I'll lead you to the green pastures of fellowship with me and my presence. No matter where you are, no matter how barren it looks, no matter how alone you feel, I will be there to give you pasture. You just nuzzle up to me, the good shepherd says, and I will take care of your needs. Praise the Lord. But maybe the greatest thing is nobody gets past the shepherd. Do you think I believe in the security of salvation? I sure do. Do you think I believe it because I'm so smart that I always stay in the fold? No. I believe it because nobody gets past my Jesus at the door. No enemy. No band of enemies. The wolf, he will not come near. Do you have a shepherd like that? Next time, we're going to find out about the next several that talk about the good shepherd. What a great introduction to him.